Hello everyone, I am Be Better Gamer, and welcome to my YouTube channel where I do Let's Plays of WCW NW Revenge, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, and WWF No Mercy, which is today's episode, and I am continuing my path on the Intercontinental Championship. This is the third path, and I as a contender, and I will be playing as the Olympic hero, our Olympic hero, Kurt Angle. Yes, it's true. Kurt Angle is finally getting his moment in WWF No Mercy. One of my favorite characters to play as in this game, only because, not because of his moveset. His moveset's pretty good. He's got a pretty good moveset, got a lot of good suplexes and stuff like that. He doesn't have the ankle lock yet because he hasn't been doing it yet when this game was made. But I just like playing as Kurt Angle because I love Kurt Angle. His run in WWF was probably one of the best runs ever. From start to finish, if you're looking at from when he debuted in WWF all the way until he left, he had a pretty solid run, a lot of solid feuds, memorable matches, and he even fought Steve Blackman during the year he debuted, and I'm gonna get into that, but he did fight Steve Blackman, so I thought that was very interesting that I'm starting out with Steve Blackman. I mean, it wasn't a barn burner, you know, him and Steve Blackman coming out, but I should note, and I didn't notice this because I fought Steve Blackman in other videos. I'm sure I fought him in like the European Championship videos. But when he comes out, you know, he's a lethal weapon. And I didn't notice this until now. You know, lethal weapon, L-E-T-H-A-L is how you spell lethal. And when he comes out, the default spelling in the game is lethal. L-E-E-A-T-H-A-L. Lethal. So, gonna fix that after I play this match. I mean, not play this match. After I finish this playthrough, gonna go in and fix the misspelling of Lethal Weapon. I don't know how they missed that up when they were developing this game. But thank you for joining me on my channel. If this is the first time you've watched any of my Let's Plays, I like to talk about the gameplay and the history of these games developed by AKI. This game came out, oh my goodness, we're almost coming on 15 years when this game came out. But I also like to talk about the historical context of what was going on in WWF and the world of wrestling around the time this game was being developed. So if we look at No Mercy in particular, No Mercy was released in November of 2000. And WrestleMania 2000, the game that, well, the WWF game that preceded No Mercy was released in November of 1999. So I like to look from that year, from November of 99 all the way until about October, November of 2000, and see what was going on in wrestling and talk about these wrestlers and, you know, what they were doing that year. And I'm doing the Intercontinental Championship title. I did my light heavyweight and my European Championship runs a little differently. I chose wrestlers who had like the longest reigns as champion. And when I was looking at the IC champion and I was gonna do it with that format, I noticed that Kurt Angle wasn't there because Kurt Angle's run as Intercontinental Champion was actually really short. He only held the title for 35 days. He didn't hold the title for long. But I feel like it's important to talk about him as the Intercontinental Champion because he did a lot. And it was a very important time in his life when he got the Intercontinental Championship. So I decided for the Intercontinental Championship series that I'm doing for the Let's Plays that I will do start from finish all the people who won the Intercontinental Championship during the year, you know, that I like to talk about from November of 99 to November of 2000. So I started with China. She was the first one. And then I did Jericho. And now I'm up to Kurt Angle because Kurt Angle would beat Jericho for the Intercontinental Championship at No Way Out 2000. Now, if you have the WWE Network, you can watch all these matches, all these pay-per-view matches that I'm going to talk about, and even some other one-off matches that I'll talk about. But yeah, Kurt Angle, if you don't know, if you never watched Kurt Angle in WWF, you know, he made his debut at Survivor Series 99, so that's perfect, right? That's just perfect. From the month that I like to start talking about, I love starting to talk about November of 99, and Kurt Angle made his debut at Survivor Series 99. It was his first televised match, first pay-per-view match, and he fought against Sean Stasiak, aka Meat, if you've played WrestleMania 2000. and it was also Sean Stasiak's first appearance on pay-per-view. the big hype about Kurt Angle coming into the WWF was that he was a legitimate superstar in the world of amateur wrestling. He was the 1996 gold medalist for the Olympic Games heavyweight freestyle in wrestling. He is one of four people to achieve a grand slam in the world of amateur wrestling, winning the junior nationals, the NCAAs, the world championship, and the Olympics. And he was trained by legendary gold medalist Dave Schultz, who actually was the subject of him and his brother were the subject of the 2014 film Foxcatcher, starring Steve Carell, Channing Tatum, and Mark Ruffalo as Dave Schultz. So he had legitimate cred. He was a big get for the WWF at the time because he was the first legitimate pro wrestling, or I should say amateur wrestling athlete who had so much. I mean, you don't get any more credibility than winning a gold medal at the Olympics. I mean, the best of the best go there. And, you know, they had another Olympian in their team. They had Mark Henry, who competed also at the 96 Olympic Games. He was the team captain of the weightlifting team there, but he didn't medal at that event, only because of injuries. But Kurt Angle would, you know, when he was being debuted, and that first match that he had was very memorable for me. I'll never forget his debut because there was so much hype about him. WWF was playing promos after promos after promos of this guy, Kurt Angle, and when he came out, and I remember the fans just were like, who is this guy? We don't care. This match is boring. They started chanting boring. And Kurt Angle got on the mic, and he was like, how dare you chant boring? I am your Olympic hero. You should be cheering for me. And right there in that moment, I was a fan. No idea who this guy was. Never seen his Olympic stuff. You know, didn't know who he was. But that, when he got on the mic there, there was something just clicked with me about him. I was like, this guy's gonna be really good. And I think he blew everyone's expectations out of the way. And I'm really excited for this episode because I think this is probably gonna be one of the best historical context episodes, because if you could say anyone had like a Rookie of the Year award, you know, like best first year ever in any federation, any organization, so-and-so, I think Kurt Angle would be at the top of the list. From making his debut, we're gonna start with Kurt Angle making his debut at Survivor Series 1999 against Sean Stasiak, and we're gonna end with him at Survivor Series 2000, and he's already the WWF World Champion by that point. This guy was incredible. It still is incredible. I mean, he's been in TNA, Impact Wrestling, for the past few years, battling neck injuries and other personal demons, which I won't really get into too much because the whole TNA, you know, his time in TNA is a whole nother episode within itself. And actually, Kurt Angle was recently the Impact Wrestling Heavyweight Champion, had to drop the title, unfortunately, because he's suffering another neck injury. And actually, a couple days ago, before I recorded this podcast, he had to be rushed back to the emergency room. So, hope he gets better and hope he continues. I still think he has a lot of energy in the tank, even for someone his age and someone who has been battling so many neck injuries. But we're going to keep it with his first year in WWE, which just so happened to perfectly line up with the year I like to talk about when I do these Let's Plays. I had to quit the match there. Just so you know, because that match, you have to beat China in under 3 minutes. And I just couldn't get the momentum going. I couldn't beat her in under 3 minutes. So I just had to restart it. There's a lot of matches where you get certain amount of continues or tries. And if you lose the match, you lose your continues. And you know, if you lose all your continues, you have to start the whole thing all over. A really easy way to bypass all that is to just quit. If you're losing a match that has, like, you only have one or two chances to beat it, and you don't want to lose those chances, just quit. That's no big deal. You know, they don't penalize you from quitting the match and starting over the championship path again, so might as well, right? Why start all the way over from the beginning? If you make a mistake or if you just weren't paying attention. And right there, I just wasn't staying on top of China as much as I should have been. That came out differently than I wanted it to. But so I just restarted it, and here I go, gonna beat her. It's not really too hard to beat in under 3 minutes. You just gotta make sure you hit it with a lot of grapples. Could be a lot of weak grapples too. Weak B grapples, not weak A grapples, because they don't do a lot of damage. You want to do weak B grapples, and then eventually you want to do your strong grapples, and then usually by the time you get your first special, you could pretty much close the match. So, and the angle slam is a really good finisher in this game. So Kurt Angle, he would go on to become 4-time WWF champion, 1-time world heavyweight champion, which was the old WCW belt that they absorbed when they bought WCW, 1-time United States heavyweight champion that they also absorbed from WCW, 1-time European champion, 1-time Intercontinental champion, 1-time tag team champion. So he pretty much was a Grand Slam champion, holding all the major titles. He was the 5th Grand Slam champion. He was the 10th Triple Crown champion. And he was also the winner of, we're going to talk about it in a little bit, the 2000 King of the Ring, which is the King of the Ring, that arena that you can select in this game is the 2000 King of the Ring. So Kurt Angle, superstar in the making right now. He debuted at Survivor Series 99. The next pay-per-view at Armageddon 99, he took on Steve Blackman, which I faced earlier, actually, in the first match, I should say. There I go, beating China in 2 minutes. See how easy that was? then at Royal Rumble 2000. Now, Royal Rumble 2000 was another big debut for someone. And at this point, Kurt Angle was undefeated. He hadn't lost a singles match. He lost a tag team match, but that was actually what caused his match with Steve Blackman. He lost the tag team match with Steve Blackman, but he didn't get pinned, so he was like, whatever, I didn't lose, you lost. And that's why they fought at Armageddon. But Royal Rumble 2000 was the debut of Taz, coming in from ECW. ECW wouldn't be around for much longer after Taz left, but that was one of the last big gets from ECW. Taz jumping ship, ECW World Heavyweight Champion. I'll do a Taz run for the Hardcore Championship, actually, so I'll talk more about that. But it was a big moment. It was at MSG. Very hyped up, Taz's debut to WWF. And he came in. He actually defeated Kurt Angle, so it was Kurt Angle's first loss since his debut at Survivor Series. He got choked out by the Taz Mission. The ref had to stop the match. And they actually never really went anywhere with that feud. I was expecting a really big feud between Kurt Angle and Taz, and I think that would have been a great way to introduce Taz. And they had a few bouts here or there, but there was never really like a pay-per-view blow-off or anything like that. And Taz went his own way, and unfortunately, he never really reached the levels of success that Kurt Angle did. But at No Way Out, which was in February of 2000, Kurt Angle would face Chris Jericho, who's making a run in right now, trying to, you know, interfere for whatever reason against Eddie Guerrero. I guess he doesn't want me to be the number one contender for the championship. Here comes Eddie Guerrero and Kurt Angle double teaming me. Don't worry, I think I'll win. But Kurt Angle and Chris Jericho would fight for the Intercontinental Championship at No Way Out 2000. By this time, Kurt Angle had already won the European Championship. So, in between Royal Rumble and No Way Out, there was an episode of SmackDown that aired on February 8th, 2000, and Kurt Angle beat Val Venis for the European Championship. And I've talked about that. I've talked about Val Venis' run as a European Champion. He has a Let's Play, so go watch that. This was basically setting up Kurt Angle. If he beat Chris Jericho, which he did, he became the 3rd and last Eurocontinental champion. So that was probably his, you know, 2nd/3rd major thing he did in the WWF. He won the European title, won the Intercontinental title, and held both at the same time, making him the Eurocontinental champion. Eurocontinental champion was basically someone who held the IC and the European title at the same time, and only D'Lo Brown and Jeff Jarrett has done that along with Kurt Angle. So another check mark in his rookie year. Very successful right off the bat. This leads us into WrestleMania. WrestleMania 2000, the actual WrestleMania 2000, not the game, which was WrestleMania 16. I think it's very interesting because, you know, WrestleMania 2000, the game was called WrestleMania 2000, and it came out like months before the actual WrestleMania 2000. But in this game, we actually get the WrestleMania 2000 arena, and this game came out after the actual WrestleMania 2000, so more of the people that are in that game, or that in that pay-per-view, you can play as in this game, like the Radicals. And it was at WrestleMania 2000 that Kurt Angle had to defend both his European and Intercontinental Championship in a triple threat match, in a two-fall triple threat match. So whoever got the first pinfall or submission would get the Intercontinental title, and whoever got the second pinfall or submission would get the European title. There I go, going for Kurt Angle's moonsault. I love Kurt Angle's moonsault in real life. He had a very pretty moonsault. He always got a lot of good elevation on it. It was always crazy that he was doing a moonsault when he started debuting the moonsault. Pretty early on, actually, he started doing the moonsault. I always thought it was pretty amazing that a guy like that would be doing moonsault. You know, this was this amateur wrestler, but then, like, all of a sudden, he can bust out a moonsault. It was, like, you know, I love it when wrestlers do that, when they do something kind of against their type. You know, here he is, he's a mat technician, you know, amateur wrestler, all these suplexes. Oh, by the way, he can do a moonsault. It was the same thing with Vader. Vader was a big powerhouse. It's like, oh, all of a sudden, he can do a moonsault. Seth Rollins is kind of like that. Seth Rollins, he's this kind of like, you know, hybrid wrestler, you know, doesn't do too many high flying stuff, but the dude can do a Phoenix Splash, which not a lot of people can do. And he can bust out a beautiful Phoenix Splash. Brock Lesnar could also, we'll talk about that actually later on, but Brock Lesnar actually has a Shooting Star Press tucked away. And unfortunately, the one time that we got to see it was at WrestleMania against Kurt Angle. I guess I'll talk about it now, you know, because, you know, we'll jump around a bit. We'll jump around a bit. But at the main event of WrestleMania 19, where Kurt Angle and Brock Lesnar fought for the World Heavyweight title, Kurt Angle was the World Heavyweight Champion, Brock Lesnar went for the Shooting Star Press. Now, he misses it because Kurt Angle was, like, all the way on the other end of the ring. And I always thought, why would he go for it that far away? And Kurt Angle was actually on an episode of Jim Ross's podcast recently. Here I'm going for a DQ. I gotta lose this match because that's just how the path is. I have to lose this match. And apparently when you hit them outside with the weapon, it doesn't count. But when you hit them inside with the weapon, it counts. So I gotta run in the ring and hit Jericho because I gotta lose this match for my championship path. You can see the path I'm taking. I put it in my little like YouTube description, the path that I have to take, you know, to 100% this thing, and I have a link to the game FAQs guide that I use. But yeah, going back to Brock Lesnar, so he's like, I remember watching it too. I watched that live. I wasn't there, but I watched it live on pay-per-view, and he was like all the way across from the end of the ring, and I had seen clips of Brock Lesnar doing on the indie scene, doing the Shooting Star Press, and it was gorgeous. It was beautiful. Here's this big dude, and he could do like a perfect Shooting Star Press. Kurt Angle was asked about Jim Ross, like, what was the deal with that spot? What was the deal with that spot with Brock Lesnar hitting the Shooting Star Press and him missing it? He almost broke his neck. He almost killed himself. Kurt Angle said that was his call. They discussed it earlier on. He said all throughout the day, Brock Lesnar was hitting the Shooting Star Press from that far. Okay. Perfectly. From that far, he was nailing it. And he said, you gotta do it. You gotta do it. That's how we're gonna finish the match. But unfortunately, when they got up there, Brock Lesnar slipped and he damn near broke his neck. And they had to call an audible and end the match differently. But that was supposed to be the finish. Brock Lesnar was supposed to hit this amazing Shooting Star Press from damn near across the ring, which apparently Kurt Angle says he was hitting perfectly before the match, before that night. It's just one of those things where it didn't go off as planned. So they still had a fantastic match. Go watch that match. Classic match. Kind of wish Kurt Angle, you know, I mean, it's good that he re-signed with Impact Wrestling because they definitely need him over there. But it would have been nice to see WWE re-sign Kurt Angle because he could rekindle the Kurt Angle Brock Lesnar feud, which was great. But anyway, let's not talk about that. Let's go back to the year. Let's go back to WrestleMania 2000. So Kurt Angle, he loses the first fall. to, well, he actually doesn't lose. This was the interesting thing about this match. The first fall, Benoit pins Jericho. So Benoit gets the IC title. The second fall, Jericho pins Benoit. So Kurt Angle doesn't actually get pinned throughout that whole match, but he loses his two titles. Of course, this makes Kurt Angle livid, and he feels like he was robbed. After the Backlash pay-per-view, Kurt Angle would be engaged with a very brief feud with The Big Show. And he calls The Big Show out because at the time, The Big Show was running around impersonating other wrestlers. He was impersonating Val Venus, you know, just all these other silly gimmicks. I forgot who else he was impersonating, but he was being very silly. So Kurt Angle was like, "You're being too silly." And they had a tag team match where Kurt Angle slapped him, and that made Big Show mad. And Big Show was going to take his revenge out on Kurt Angle at Backlash. And that's when The Big Show comes out as the Showster. He basically comes out as Hulk Hogan. You know, he comes out to the real American music. He's wearing the yellow and red. And his shirt says Showster instead of Hulkster. Big Show's not in No Mercy, the game, because it was shortly after this point that Big Show was punished by WWF. There was a lot of things going on backstage, and apparently Big Show wasn't getting along too well with some of the guys or some of the, you know, higher ups, and there was, you know, talk about Big Show not losing weight that he needed to and this and that. So they sent him down to their development as sort of punishment, but they took away all his TV time, they took away all his merchandise, because they wanted to, like, keep him in check, you know. Big Show was coming into the WWF. He was already WCW World Champion. He was a big star, so they wanted to knock him down a peg and make sure that he wasn't getting too egotistical. And they also wanted to protect their investment, Jim Ross would say, because, you know, Big Show, they felt Big Show was leading an unhealthy life, yada, yada, yada. After this, you really wouldn't see the Big Show too much on TV. So Big Show doesn't make it into No Mercy, but I actually created the Big Show for my WrestleMania 2000 memories video. And you can recreate Big Show pretty much perfectly because they have the Big Dirty Bastard t-shirt. And they have the Showster t-shirt that you can buy in the SmackDown shop. So if you want to make the Big Show, you totally can in this game. Got all his moves, got all his outfits. Go ahead, go make the Big Show. So anyway, getting back to Kurt Angle. So he would lose to Big Show because nothing, you can't stop Hulk Hogan, let alone Big Show impersonating Hulk Hogan. So at Insurrection 2000, Kurt Angle would have a singles match with Chris Benoit. No title on the line, just a match between them. And this would be sort of like the beginning of their rivalry of just being two intense competitors. Every time they would meet up, they would meet up at the next WrestleMania after this, just a one-on-one match, which was a great match. But Kurt Angle would beat Chris Benoit. Chris Benoit had a really nasty black eye during this match. Oh, it's disgusting. But Judgment Day, May 2000. So this is where Kurt Angle started teaming up with Edge and Christian. And Edge and Christian were the hottest tag team in WWE this year, or that year, I should say, along with the Hardy Boys. And it's kind of fitting that Grandmaster Sexy is coming out, because at Judgment Day, you had Too Cool, which was Sky Too Hottie, Grandmaster Sexy, and the, you know, insanely popular at the time, Rikishi, against Kurt Angle, Edge, and Christian. And this was Team ECK. And this match is kind of significant if you look 1 year later, because Too Cool would beat Team ECK, right? You know, no big deal. It was just like a one-off match. And Team ECK wouldn't stay around for too much longer. But in this match, so you have Kurt Angle teaming with Edge and Christian. 1 year later at Judgment Day, two years later at Judgment Day 2002, Edge would take on Kurt Angle in a hair versus hair match. And that's when Kurt Angle would shave his head, and he kept his head bald pretty much ever since after that. So I thought that was interesting that Kurt Angle and Edge had this relationship at Judgment Day 2000 when they fought together, and then 2 years later at Judgment Day he would get his head shaved. So a little foreshadowing there, if you will. But here we are, we're moving on to the King of the Ring, and that's actually where I am right now in the chapters in this playthrough. I'm doing the King of the Ring, and Kurt Angle would enter the King of the Ring. he would face Chris Jericho in the quarterfinal match at the pay-per-view, and he would beat Jericho, he would beat Crash Holly in the semifinals, and then he would go on to face and defeat Rikishi in the finals match. At this time, Kurt Angle was creating an on-screen relationship with Stephanie McMahon. It was a friendship thing at first, but it would later evolve into a sort of romantic kind of relationship, and that would create this love triangle between Kurt Angle, Triple H, and Stephanie McMahon. And this was the beginning of it. This was the time where Kurt Angle was beginning to rise from the mid-card to the top card of the WWF. We're getting to the middle of the year, and Kurt Angle has won the King of the Ring, back when winning the King of the Ring actually meant something. I'm looking at you, King Barrett. And so this was his rise. So yeah, so that Intercontinental Championship match that he had at WrestleMania, that was pretty much it. That was the last time you would see Eddie Guerrero make an actual attempt at the IC Championship. He would be in a one-off match at on an episode of Raw in September of 2000, where he was involved in a triple threat match between China and Eddie Guerrero. And I actually talked about this in my China Let's Play. That was China's second reign. It was very short-lived, because it was right after the Unforgiven pay-per-view, where China had won the championship in a tag team intergender match. And then, you know, Eddie Guerrero and China would have this match. It was after SummerSlam she won it, and then they would have this match, and it was a triple threat match, and Eddie Guerrero would get the victory. So Kurt Angle was involved in that, but that's it pretty much for Intercontinental Championship run. Still, to win your Intercontinental Championship the first year, to win your European Championship that same year and also at the same time, and then to win the King of the Ring, I mean, you talk about your three eyes. You know, Kurt Angle definitely backed up what he preached, having a breakout year so far, but this is where you would start to see him get involved with the main event picture. Also, a thing I would like to point out about King of the Ring, so Kurt Angle wins King of the Ring 2000. 2001 King of the Ring is probably one of my favorite matches of all time. And I'm talking about Kurt Angle versus Shane McMahon. If you haven't watched Kurt Angle versus Shane McMahon, 2001 King of the Ring, go watch it. WWE Network, one of my favorite matches of all time, because it did two things. First of all, again, this was the second year we had Kurt Angle, okay? Kurt Angle was hot. He was kept getting better and better and better. And when you watch a lot of these early matches with Kurt Angle, it's pretty much amazing, because you feel like you're watching a guy that's been doing this for years. And yeah, he was amateur wrestling and one of the best amateur wrestlers around, but never in a professional wrestling ring. You know, it's different, a whole different animal. But he picked it up like it was nothing. You know, like this guy, those early matches, even leading up to the King of the Ring, he looked like a stud. You know, he's in there with Jericho and they're having this great match. And you think they've been wrestling each other for 10 years, like in the Japanese circuit and in WCW. Like, they, just the chemistry he had with a lot of the other wrestlers and how good he was naturally in the WWF. I mean, he just got better and better every month, every year, every match. And 2001 King of the Ring, he was just a rocket to the moon. Like, that's how good he was. And Shane McMahon was doing a great job of, you know, getting a lot of people to realize he's not just the son of Vince McMahon. He's going to take these big bumps, these big falls, and he's going to, you know, steal Rob Van Dam's Van Terminator and do all these crazy things. But it was that match that solidified for me that Shane McMahon was legit. Just that whole spot where Kurt Angle's trying to belly-to-belly suplex him to the glass, and the glass won't break, and Kurt Angle talks about it in that very same podcast with Jim Ross about how, the glass wasn't breaking, and Shane McMahon landed on his head. He's, like, pretty much knocked out, and Shane McMahon is like, do it again, and, like, until they can, and then finally Kurt Angle just had to throw him into the glass, because the belly-to-belly suplex into the glass wasn't working. Fantastic match. They beat the crap out of each other. I think that helped put both of them on the mat. Like, if you had doubted Kurt Angle from already winning the IC title, winning the European title, becoming the world champion in his first year, and holding it for several months, and defending it in great matches, if you still doubted him by the time you got to King of the Ring 2001, and if you doubted Shane McMahon, I think that silenced all critics. Stole the night, you know. That match was definitely more important than the King of the Ring itself. And I still remember that match to this day. So another foreshadowing, if you will, the Kurt Angle's legacy with the King of the Ring wouldn't just stop with him winning in his debut King of the Ring tournament. So let's go to Fully Loaded, July 23rd, 2000. Kurt Angle would get on The Undertaker's bad side. This was The Undertaker was doing his biker gimmick, the American Badass gimmick. And Undertaker, Kurt Angle would fight. It was a pretty good physical match. This was, Kurt Angle's stepping stone to feuding with the main event Carters, and he feuded with Undertaker. Undertaker would beat him, but this was just a setup for a few months down the road. At SummerSlam, big match. This was it. This was Kurt Angle's first main event match. Rock, Kurt Angle, Triple H for the championship, WWF Championship. Rock was the six-time WWF champion at this point. Hottest thing in the company. Stone Cold was out because of injury and starting to come back around this time. That's when they started doing the whole who hit Stone Cold Steve Austin with a car angle. And so they would fight. You had the backstory of the Kurt Angle and Triple H and Stephanie McMahon love thing going on here. But the highlight of this match was the match started out with Triple H and Kurt Angle going at it, and The Rock hadn't come in yet. But there was so much bad blood there between Triple H and Kurt Angle, and they started fighting, beating the crap out of each other. They go to the outside, they go to the announcer table, which you could do in this game, which was great. They added that feature in this game. Kurt Angle and Triple H, they're on the announcer table. Triple H is about to do the pedigree onto Kurt Angle, onto the Spanish announcer table. The announcer table buckles right before he does it, and Kurt Angle just gets driven headfirst into the floor, immediately gets a concussion. You could just see it. Like, go back and watch it. You just see it. It's one of the most memorable moments. And I think this is the match. After going back and watching all these matches from Survivor Series 99 to Survivor Series of 2000, you know, that WrestleMania match between Benoit and Jericho definitely established Kurt Angle as a legitimate great wrestler that can hold his own with experienced wrestlers who have traveled all over the world, like Benoit and Jericho. But this was the match that said, yep, Kurt Angle is ready for the main event, because he took that bump, and you just know that changed the whole dynamic of the match, because Kurt Angle was legitimately hurt. The dude did not know where he was for like the good like next 10 minutes almost. And he still would come back and finish the match. And finish the match with such intensity. Almost as if he didn't even get a concussion earlier before. Like, it's just crazy. Like, 1 minute, you could just see it in his eyes. He just doesn't know where he is. And there's a whole point where they bring him out on the stretcher. And Triple H goes there and tries to get him off the stretcher. And even then, Kurt Angle is still looking around, doesn't know what's going on. But then all of a sudden, just something clicks. He just wakes up out of it, and they start having the match. You know they were going to have, and it's a great match. Go watch that match. That was probably my favorite match of this year. I mean, as much as I love the WrestleMania 2000 match, I really did forget how good that SummerSlam match was between The Rock, Kurt Angle, and Triple H, and especially considering this is Kurt Angle's big moment, like big match event, you know, since WrestleMania, since coming into the company, for him to take that bump where he got the concussion and to finish the match the way he did, fantastic. That, for me, put it over. The Rock retains the title, though, and that would lead into Unforgiven, where Triple H with Stephanie McMahon will go up against Kurt Angle in a no DQ match with Mick Foley as the special guest referee. And if you want to relive this match, you can, because WWF No Mercy, they have the special guest referee. mode in this one, so you can definitely do that. This was a good match too, very physical match. I think this match was more so about putting Triple H over as a babyface and really establishing Kurt Angle as a heel. But again, that intensity still shines in Kurt Angle, and it's something I always loved. He preached about it all the time, but it was true, man. It was just, you know, he had this cookie-cutter look about him, but then when he got to the ring, it was all business. And that was one of the things I loved about Kurt Angle's gimmick, because it was a reflection of real life. I mean, this dude is intense. They call him the machine, the sideboard. I mean, to this day, people say he was one of the best shoot wrestlers around. One of the toughest guys around, one of the hardest workers around, and even today, with all the neck injuries he's sustained over the years, I mean, he even wrestled in the Olympics with a broken neck, and that's all legit. And he never let that stop him. He never let that stop him from giving a good performance, from going out there, giving it his all, and, you know, you gotta respect a guy like that. I mean, you know, he had a lot of personal demons too, like every freaking wrestler, it seems like. But you can't doubt his hard work, his talent, his ability, his work ethic, his showmanship, everything about him. And, you know, that's why I love Kurt Angle. Here we go. I'm fighting Chris Jericho for the IC Championship to finish out this path. But, you know, him and Triple H would go after that, would have that match at Unforgiven. He'd lose the match. But on an episode of Raw leading up to No Mercy 2000, which is the pay-per-view this game is named after, Kurt Angle would get the number one contendership to face The Rock. So this would be his second main event match in WWF. And he would beat The Rock for the World Heavyweight Championship. And then at Survivor Series 2000, he would defend the championship again against The Undertaker, who he lost to at Fully Loaded, but he would beat The Undertaker. And this would continue. This would continue all the way until No Way Out 2001, where Kurt Angle would lose the World Heavyweight Championship against The Rock to set up Rock versus Austin 2 at WrestleMania. So, talk about Rookie of the Year. Probably one of the best years ever for any superstar. I really can't think of any other, you know, maybe Goldberg, obviously. That's another one. Standout first year debut from start to finish. But, you know, Goldberg, Kurt Angle, like, who else? Like, if you can think of in the comments, if you can think of anyone from any promotion, doesn't have to be WWF, doesn't have to be WCW, could be ECW, could be New Japan, All Japan, whatever. You know, AAA, CMLL, Ring of Honor. Let me know someone else who had such a great, not only first year in their company, but then would go on and keep getting better. I mean, how do you top becoming the European champion, Intercontinental champion, King of the Ring, and world champion in your first year? Well, just look at the rest of the accomplishments that Kurt Angle did. The rest of the feuds that Kurt Angle was a part of. You know, his legacy in WWF and in Impact Wrestling. I mean, this guy's a future WWE Hall of Famer. That's going to be interesting when that happens. You know, when they induct WWE, you know, because WWE right now, they don't even talk about Impact Wrestling. And that was very noticeable when Sting came, because Sting was apparently, he disappeared for 10 years, is what they said repeatedly. And then you went away for 10 years, Sting. Like, he didn't go away. He was wrestling at Impact. But that's what WWF does. They like to not acknowledge other companies. Only when they want to. So that's going to be interesting, because Kurt Angle is definitely a Hall of Famer. And he would leave WWF in 2006. So, you know, from 1999 to 2006. Fantastic run. Fantastic first year run. I think it just works out so perfectly. That's why I wanted to do Kurt Angle for the IC Championship. I basically changed my whole format for the IC Championship just so I could talk about Kurt Angle, because if I was just going to keep it with, like, most reigns as IC Champion, Kurt Angle wouldn't fit the bill. He only held it as 35 days, but if you watch wrestling at this time, if you bought No Mercy when it came out, everyone remembered Kurt Angle as the Eurocontinental Champion. That was such a big deal. Very historic. He was the last one to do it. So you gotta give him an IC Championship run. But this isn't the end of Kurt Angle. When I do my World Heavyweight Championship run, I will be doing a Kurt Angle World Heavyweight Championship run, because again, if I'm following the same format as we've just talked about, Kurt Angle won the World Heavyweight Championship. So, not the end of Kurt Angle, but I don't want to talk too much about his World Championship matches now, because I want to save that for the, you know, for that Let's Play series. But, you know, I'm facing against Chris Jericho, and this is really interesting. I wasn't expecting this. I wasn't expecting a, Iron Man match to close out this Intercontinental Championship. It's a 10-minute Iron Man match. Thank goodness. Thank goodness it's not an hour or half an hour. But it's a 10-minute Intercontinental Championship match, and I thought I was going to pick up more victories than I did, honestly. Chris Jericho was just being really good at, avoiding a lot of my stuff and countering some stuff. I got one pinfall from him already, but he's not making it easy for me to just keep pinning him. The thing about the Iron Man match, it's not as fun to play it against the computer, honestly. Even if you're playing on the hard difficulty, like if I were to do a hard difficulty Iron Man match, just regular exhibition, it's not that hard because your fatigue wears on you throughout the whole match. So if you're able to get a good momentum going, you can pick up victories pretty easily, honestly. Especially if you're using someone who uses submission moves, because then once you've made a guy tap out with submission moves, they'll repeatedly tap out after that, unless they get the rope break. So for example, if I was playing against Jericho and I had made Kurt Angle tap out with the Lion Tamer, I can do it again and again and again and again and again. And so it's kind of unfair playing against the computer because they don't exploit that system as much as, you know, you would as a human player. Here I go, I'm trying to pin him with the moonsault. I'm trying to switch it up. I'm trying to make every victory different. But see, boom, right there. Pretty easy. Pretty much in a minute since the last time I had pinned him, I'm able to pull off a victory. Unfortunately, if I was able to do my Olympic Slam right there, I would have been able to pick up another quick victory, but I should have seen that weak grapple coming and I didn't. So I highly recommend, though, playing Iron Man matches with a friend. Iron Man matches are really fun to play as with a friend, because when you get to that point when both of your wrestlers are fatigued and it becomes really easy to get a victory off of someone, that's when it starts getting very competitive. That's when it starts getting very intense. And the tide can turn at any moment. And it's great. It's great. I do like the Iron Man match feature in this game, but only against the a human opponent. I don't really recommend it against a computer opponent because it's a little too easy. So playing against a friend is fun with the Iron Man match. And I've never done an hour-long Iron Man match. I've only done, I think the most I've ever done was a half hour Iron Man match. But even then, that's kind of lengthy. But usually 15-minute Iron Man matches are good. You get a lot of pinfalls and submissions in that. And so yeah, we're coming up on the 2-minute mark for this Iron Man match. Unfortunately, Angle doesn't have the ankle lock. That would have been a great way to make Chris Jericho's tap out with the ankle lock. But you can see here, Chris Jericho's got his comeback special going. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to get a third victory over it. I doubt Jericho's done enough damage to actually make me tap out to the walls of Jericho if he's able to get it off, or even if he is able to get off his double powerbomb special. Honestly, he's not going to put me away. The whole match, I've just been dominating Jericho. So this is pretty much in the bag for the IC title. I should also mention that both the outfits I'm wearing, the outfit that Kurt Angle's wearing, I chose because that's the outfit that he beat Jericho with, and Jericho's wearing the outfit that when he won the IC title with. So I'm going to try to do that also going forward with a lot of the IC champions. I'm going to try to have them wear the outfit they wore when they won the IC title. Actually, that's not true. That's not the outfit that Jericho won. I mentioned this in my video. He wore that outfit at Royal Rumble 2000 when he defended the title against China and Hardcore Holly in a triple threat match. But nonetheless, that's Kurt Angle's outfit that he wore. Kurt Angle started wearing these really cool half and half kind of outfits with a lot of stars and and stripes. They were very colorful. They don't have those outfits in this game, unfortunately, but I really always loved those outfits. They just have his basic debut outfit and like his regular red outfit and blue outfit with like the sort of American flag on the sides. But Kurt Angle always had a cool attire too. And yeah, maybe I'll do a video when he went bald and talk about when he went bald. But you'll definitely see Kurt Angle in the World Heavyweight Championship run. Who's after this? After this is going to be Benoit, obviously, because Benoit won the IC title from Kurt Angle. I mean, he beat Jericho. He didn't beat Kurt Angle, but he won it at WrestleMania 2000. So that's going to be the next one that I talk about. I'm going to do Chris Benoit. Yeah, and I'm just pretty much just kind of waiting out. Like that's the thing about the Iron Man match. Like, I already won twice. Now I got to just wait out the time. But we're getting down to the last few seconds. I mean, you know what I would like to see? I would have liked to see that maybe like, and they kind of have this in like the newer games where you can get an instant special if like you counter someone's special. So like if I'm going for the Angle Slam, even though Kurt Angle's not in, you know, 2K15, but just using him as an example, if I'm going for the Angle Slam and then I'm able to counter it as Jericho, Jericho would steal his finisher. That would have been kind of cool to have in this game because, you know, for these Iron Man matches, you could steal a finisher, or maybe if you got hit with a finisher and you got pinned, maybe right away your meter would jump to red, and so to sort of give you an advantage to come back into it. That would have made it very compelling. And they don't do that in the Iron Man matches in the newer games. That would still be a really kind of a cool feature to do, but there we go. All said and done. Kurt Angle, it's true. Rookie of the year, definitely this year, from 99 to 2000, November to November. Hope you enjoyed this video. I love Kurt Angle. Watch that match, the WrestleMania 2000 match. Watch that triple threat match, SummerSlam 2000. Definitely the highlight of his year. Hope you enjoyed this video. I got more videos coming up every Friday. So leave a like if you enjoyed this video. Please leave your comments. I love reading them. And subscribe so you're ready for when my next video comes out. I'm going to try to upload them every Friday. So until then, until next Friday, keep watching wrestling. And I'll see you next time. Thank you. Bye-bye.